Hello everyone, and welcome to the final talk in this first session, which will be about data management plans. Why do we have them? What goes in them? And what might they look like? In this talk, we'll cover the first two sections you can see on the screen here. I'll introduce the idea of the data management plan, or DMP, the motivation behind it, and the content that it should include, and then talk a bit about the strategy for writing it, how to plan what you'll write, how to approach your writing style, and what resources might help you. Then in the afternoon, after the break, you can have a more in-depth look at some specific requirements from funders and at some sample answers from real DMPs. So let's begin. What is a data management plan? It's a document, we don't specify the format, which specifies how data will be handled during and after a research project. And the key words here, in my opinion, are specifies and during and after. We've already seen the data life cycle. The data management plan needs to cover all stages of it. The management plan itself belongs to the planning stage, but it should account for what happens to the data in every stage of this cycle. It should include your strategy for how you want to deal with data, which is both the practicalities and perhaps any motivation you might have for that. It should include tools you want to use, and these would be the tools for collecting, generating, storing data. So it could be software that you use to analyze, it could be your codes, it could be visualization tools. You'll include the procedures for all stages. How will you collect? How will you analyze? How will you store? How will you disseminate data? The responsibilities involved in this. So there'll be several people responsible for the handling of data. There'll be the people involved directly in the research group, and there might also be others. And this should be quite explicit. So we might say, this person is responsible for this stage. This might change later, but it's good to have all responsibilities accounted for in a concrete way so that everybody doesn't think it's someone else's problem. And you should also think about the resources you want or need, which ones are already available and which ones you might have to ask for in addition from your funder or your institute. So this could be financial resources, human resources. You might need extra personnel if you find that there are a lot of responsibilities or you need some extra knowledge. Could also be things like extra training courses for your team. So why should we write a document like this? Why should we do this extra work? Well, the short answer is that it's not really going to be an option anymore. It's already required for quite a few research proposals, and the emphasis on the data management aspect of the proposal is only increasing. So more funders are making the data management plan mandatory, and they're asking for more of it or more detail. I don't think this should be our main answer though. The real reason why you should write a data management plan is that it actually improves your research. It helps you to create a research plan which is well thought out, it's thorough, and also responsive. When you've planned what you'll do when your data goes wrong, you might have made plans A, B, and C for how you're going to conduct your research. And what you'll do if, for example, a member of your team leaves and takes their computer with them, or if your university gets shut down by a pandemic. You can't foresee these things, but you can make a backup plan and you can be better equipped to deal with what might happen in your research. You can actually produce better data, more usable, more well documented, more focused and suited to purpose data. This kind of planning supports collaboration and effective teamwork and allows you to facilitate them better, because if the data can be accessed by the right people without a lot of fuss or emails or phone calls, things will run more smoothly. It can help you adhere to the FAIR data principles or any other principles you might want to follow, because there's a big difference between saying, I support the FAIR data principles, they sound great, and really understanding day to day how you're going to make that work. And it can help you to foresee and therefore avoid any technical or even legal hurdles, because part of the data management plan would include things like licensing. So, we know what it is, we know why it has to be, but what should we actually write in there? Unfortunately, that's not something I can tell you. The real content of your data management plan will depend on your project and your data, and also the way that you want to work. You might have a very focused data management plan, you might not. You might have only simulation data, you might have experimental data, you might have a small team, you might have a big team. Your funders might also want different things from you. What I can tell you are some common elements that you should always have in mind. So first of all, it's always good to include a general description of the project and the data that will be used or generated in that project and why. Why do you need these data for this project? Another basic thing to include are the types or formats and amount of data that you expect to use. A really key thing is how you will name and label things and the metadata you plan to use. And this is one of the points where you should get as specific as you can. Your plans might change, but you should really know, your whole team should really know what the plan is here. You should discuss the short and long-term storage of your data. So how the research team and any collaborators will store it during the project, but also how you'll store it long-term for safety, security, and potential reuse. You should, while you're doing all of these things, consider all of the stakeholders in your project. And by stakeholders, I mean contributors. So people doing the research in the project or contributing data directly. Collaborators who you work with during the research. This might include slightly external people such as the Nomad team. Beneficiaries, who are people who will in some way use your results or your data later. So there might be a very obvious beneficiary, like if your project is producing something for a group of people, but there might be less obvious ones. So think about who or what kinds of projects might wish to reuse your data in the future and to what extent you want to support that. And also, of course, the people who are paying for all of this, the funders, have a stake in your project and should be included. You should also always have resources in mind, both what you want or need and what's already available to you, so that you can make sure to ask for what you need. So this could be equipment, it could be personnel, and it could be training courses to educate the team you already have and how to do this non-trivial extra job. And often there will be some mention of FAIR or similar principles. How will you make your data FAIR? Will you make your data FAIR? To what extent? So you will have to think about this at some point. We've talked about a lot of work that has to be done now. So I'd like to briefly go through the positives and, for the sake of clarity and honesty, the negatives of adding data management planning into your project workflow. So what are the good things? We've already said it's part of proposals, which is definitely a pro because it helps you get funding. It supports wider project planning. This is definitely useful. It can help prepare you for issues you might encounter along the way, make you more resilient. It can help you define your workflows for during the project. If you've thought about how the data will be handled, you've probably thought about how different people's jobs will be done day to day. It can ensure project longevity because your data are not only stored somewhere, but can be accessed by the right people and can be kept safe as needed. It can make adhering to FAIR principles easier, again, because there's a big gap between liking them and doing them, and that takes a bit of thought and planning. And in the long term, it really can save you some time and effort, kind of because of a lot of the things we mentioned above. You're prepared, your team is prepared, you're on the same page, and you're ready to collaborate without having to constantly ask or rethink how that will work. And one thing to also keep in mind is that if you make your data reusable, you can end up with more citations. What are the downsides? Well, one is, of course, time investment. These things don't write themselves. It's also a lot of work at the beginning of, or even before the project, which can be more of a struggle because the project maybe isn't even funded yet and you're putting more work into it. This takes a toll both on your timetable and to some extent your mind. This is true. And it's not a comprehensive project plan. So the data management plan doesn't give you everything you need for a successful project. It's really helpful, but it's not everything. So it's a big chunk and it's still not the whole plan. All of this being said, most things that are worth doing take some effort and some time investment. And the list of pros is much longer than the list of cons here, so I hope we've persuaded you that this is something worth really taking seriously rather than just a box checking exercise. So now let's actually talk about the work of writing this document. The first thing is to plan how you will write your plan, as bizarre as it might sound. So any document that you want to take seriously deserves some planning, and we should think about the who, how, when, and where of your data management plan. So who is involved in writing? There are the people who will actually write the document, which will probably be the person leading the project writing the proposal, but may well also involve some other group members, because you could of course delegate certain sections or even the whole thing to someone else. So for example, if you're a PhD student and you're thinking, I'm not writing any proposals right now, I'm sure I don't have to write a data management plan, I would not be too confident. You may be asked to help, and that's a good thing. It's a good opportunity to learn. You should also think about the people whose knowledge you will use, who you will ask for input, although they will never directly write anything. This could be people who provide certain services, could be a data steward, someone from a software development team, someone who provides you with data from another project, technicians, anyone who helps you out in your research on some level. And it could also be people who might have certain requirements for you, as well as guidelines, such as your institute or your funding body. For the how, I really mean, how are you going to write it? What's it going to look like? You might just open an empty Word document and start writing. You might find there's a template provided by your funding, your institute, or just some kind person on the internet that helps you to organize your plan, gives you some structure in advance. And as a kind of subset of templates, there are online tools. So these are usually based on various templates, and they kind of put it into an online form format and save all of your answers and give you different options for how you want to save and share the final document. We'll talk more about templates and tools in a moment and in quite a bit of detail this afternoon. Then there's the when. Of course, you'll have some deadline for when you want to submit your whole proposal, but it's always good to think a bit earlier than that, because there will be information that needs to be collected for the data management plan. It's very unlikely that the team already knows everything they need to know about data management. Even if you've done similar projects before, resources and rules change, they grow and they develop. Take some time to research it. And then I'd recommend imposing some internal deadlines. You ask someone in the group to find out information about storage options by October 27th. And then the where is where you keep the document as you're writing it as a team. One thing to think about is sort of safety, security, privacy, making sure enough people can access it, but that it's not public because you may not want that. And also minimizing chaos in the writing process. So I would never recommend emailing a document around and letting the title get longer and longer as people add their initials, but rather find some tool designed for co-editing online that lets you track who has made what edits and all the versions of your document. It'll give you a much easier time. Probably already do this for other documents in your life. The length and writing style will depend on quite a few things, not only what is being asked of you, but also how you write and how your group members write and how much needs to be done for your project, because this will vary a lot. So I won't tell you how to express yourself or how much to write for any given question, but there are some guidelines that you could follow. So make sure that your answers are complete. You'll probably be responding to a series of prompts or questions, and you want to make sure that you address everything in there. Don't leave a gap. You might leave something unanswered because it just doesn't pertain to you. There might be questions about, for example, ethics that are clearly more aimed at medical studies. If you leave something empty, make sure that at least you know why, and maybe even mention why. This isn't relevant to our project because, and it shows that you've really thought about everything rather than it's empty because you don't know. Be specific. Don't just say, we'll include metadata, we'll make things fair and accessible. Say what kind, how, what scheme you'll follow, things like this. Give links where they're relevant. Make sure the information you write is actually relevant to the document and to the section of the document. So don't make it sort of confusingly ordered. If you're writing about accessibility, only write about things relevant to accessibility. And this feeds into my last point, which is that this document should be concise and easy to understand. In the best case, quite a lot of people will use this document. You want the person who evaluates your funding proposal to have an easy time understanding it so that they can see what you've done and approve of it. But you also will need to go back to it yourself, and your group or collaborators might need to refer to it. And if the document is simple and easy to read, but also thorough, that reduces the need for additional questions by email or phone and the risk of misunderstanding and somebody making a mistake. So this is a favor to everyone, including your future self. In the second half of this tutorial, we'll actually look at some real sample content from data management plans and the prompts that it was responding to. And none of these answers claim to be a perfect model, but they'll show you some of the variety in the ways that people approach this and maybe help you develop the style that you would like to write in. So I mentioned that your institute or funder might provide a template to help you with your data management plan. So let's look at some of the kind of templates that are out there. So the first one we have here is from the DFG, and it's called the Checklist Regarding the Handling of Research Data. So they have 6 recommended sections that your DMP should include, and for each one, some guiding questions. You might see from the picture that this is not really a template and that it's not a document to write in. It's more guidelines, not necessarily very strict ones, for a document you write yourself. So next we have this Horizon 2020 template, which is similar, but with perhaps a bit more for you. So again, we have these defined sections to fill in, and for each there's a short list of guiding questions. There's also this supplementary table with some extra hints or different formulations that you can use. Here we have the guiding questions, and here we can see a little snippet of the supplementary table. This is actually also a document that you can write directly into. You can download it as a Word file, and there are some guidelines about how you should format your responses so that it fits in nicely and is easy to read. And finally, we have another ERC template, which is a bit different again. So here, we have a small list of defined sections to fill in, our headings, but this time each one is followed by a box that you write directly into. So they're giving you more of a hint about how much content they want for each. And the list of prompts or questions is maybe a bit shorter, but very similar in content. Building on the templates, in a way, there are online tools that can help you create your DMP. And usually if you use one of these, you'll be able to choose what template you want it to use from a list. And they might have some of the major funding bodies or institutes, and they also might have custom ones that users or the tool providers have put in. So you can have quite a choice there. I'm not going to recommend any particular tool. In our resources later, you'll be able to see some information about the different tools out there. Here are just some logos for your web browsing enjoyment. Well, we can't recommend a tool. We can talk about how to best choose one. So the first question should be, if your funder or institute provides or maybe demands a particular tool or a particular template, because then the decision process is over. If you are looking at tools, there's a good chance you want to use a particular template, maybe from a funding body, maybe based on your own preferences. So you should see if that tool actually provides something based on that template. Not all tools provide all templates. You can usually search this quite easily on the tool's website. You could look at which export format or formats the tool offers. Can you only get a Word document of it or a PDF, or can you maybe get something machine actionable like a JSON file? A practical concern is how can others access the tool? Does it require downloading or installing any software? Does it require a login? This will affect how easy collaboration is, so you have to balance how good the tool is with how hard it is to use. Most of them are not very challenging. Some of them do require an installation. And this relates to the next point, which is how does this tool facilitate collaboration? Does it allow for multiple authors or editors on a document, and can you track changes from different people? Another question you might ask is what license applies to the DMP created with the tool in case you want to share this or use this beyond the project proposal. So in our last minute, I'll try to quickly summarize the most important points of everything I just said. So before we start writing our data management plan, we have to plan for it. Understand what's required. Also find out what resources are available, whether you already have access to them or not. Assign tasks around data management and around writing the data management plan, and set some deadlines. Then we have the writing. So choose some tool or template that suits you and can help you the best. When writing, stay specific and thorough, but remember to also keep it simple because this is a functional document. And finally, there's also the revision. So this document will be used and it will be applied to a living project. And so you should be open to editing your data management strategy as the project evolves. When it comes to the resources that can help you write your data management plan and with data management in general, they're evolving and changing at quite a rate. So as I've already said, I don't want to recommend any named resources in this talk because it could go out of date. But we do have a page on the FAIRmat website where we keep an updated list of useful things. This includes funding requirements for Europe, checklists and guidelines for writing the data management plan, online tools and the templates they are generally based on, and also some organizations, some people, ourselves, but also others who can help you when it comes to data management planning. So bookmark this page. It's also going to be available on the webpage for this tutorial, so don't worry if you don't have time to scan the QR code just now.